7:30. So thank you all for coming to this event tonight. I'm Sarah Thompson, the publisher and CEO of Women's Post Media, and I'm going to be the moderator tonight. First of all, I'll do a quick intro of our panel. I'd like to introduce Annabel Lau. She is our City Council for Ward 18. She also chairs the Affordable Housing Committee. Next is John Tory. He was the former leader of the PC Party of Ontario. He's currently a host of the Live Drive on News Talk 1010 and chair of Civic Action Alliance. And last but not least, we have Alfredo Romano, CEO of Castle Point Developments. So what we'll do is we'll start out with a 2-minute intro on your position on affordable housing, and then we'll go into questions, and then we'll open up the floor to questions. So let's see, who would like to start? Alfredo, would you like to start?
Operating, thank you. Thank you, first of all, Sarah, for having everybody congregate over this very, very significant issue. It's something that requires our immediate attention. That's everyone, particularly in our industry, the development industry. Certainly, in Anna's capacity as chair of the Affordable Housing Committee and in her capacity as a member of City Council, and certainly Mr. Tory with his vast experience in the political realm. And I think I'm very honored to be joining these very fine people in addressing this issue. So thank you, Sarah. And thank you, thanks to Women's Post. So I'm going to be a little bit provocative by saying that our industry, in particular, is not doing its fair share. There are a number of excellent examples of developers doing very, very fine work in the area of affordable housing. Certainly, Regent Park comes to mind, Daniels Corporation. I know they've been vilified in the press lately, but I think unfairly so. I think they've done an excellent job in working with the city as a partner to regenerate an area which is, to say the least, very compromised and troubled by its design, by its history, and by its mostly by its design. And so going into that marketplace and creating a new opportunity for a mix of affordable and market housing was a stroke of genius. I think a lot of credit has to go to Daniels and the City of Toronto for coming up with a great program and a great project. I'm going to be a little bit provocative by saying that every development in the city should be participating in this program of creating affordable housing. And not every project does, not every developer does. And there's a reason for that. There's different policies that apply in different areas. But what should occur is a consistent policy across the Toronto CMA, across all of the region, that would force each project to include a minimum percentage of affordable. In some cases, you'll find affordable requirements where on the waterfront in Toronto, for example, they're trying to enforce 20% affordable rental of the development projects. But this is land only. It's a very fine distinction. So developers are asked to provide land so that affordable can be built. However, it doesn't necessarily mean it will get built. All it means is you've got a piece of land. Therefore,
she's trying to cut you off.
So just to make the point, the fact is that 20% requirement is being objected to. It probably will not be enforced. And even when it is enforced, you have a fiasco, like the one that occurred in the railway lines where the land was never taken up for affordable. It was taken back by the city and had to be sold because no one would come forth and build it. So I'll have a little bit more to say about it, but it's a very provocative idea, and the industry should step up and actually not just deliver land or cash, but actually build a small percentage of affordable rental units in each and every project across the GTA. The numbers are staggering once you carefully analyze them, and it would go a long way. It's not the only solution, but it's certainly a very provocative and, I think,
thank you,
feasible solution.
Anna? Okay, I think, make sure I can say all this in 2 minutes. I just wanted to give you a little bit of a background on the situation that we currently have in Toronto. So Toronto has currently a waiting list of about 80,000 people. Toronto Community Housing has close to 60,000 units and about 160,000 tenants. That's 7% of all the renters in the city of Toronto. We're the largest landlord in North America, and we have a backlog of repairs of $750 million. So I call that a crisis in our hands. Affordability in the city of Toronto is decreasing, and we already have a problem. So we definitely need a national housing strategy. That is something that I think all these issues that we've been talking about in the city of Toronto need to be put on the agenda. We need to identify, we need to make sure that the city has an intergovernmental strategy to deal both with the province and with the federal government. Something that I think all these issues that we've been talking about in the city of Toronto need to be put on the agenda. We need to identify, we need to make sure that the city has an intergovernmental strategy to deal both with the province and with the federal government. It is important, however, to realize the financial constraints that the three levels of government are living with. So it is essential that we bring the private sector into the table. Alfred is right. We cannot solve this problem without having the private sector to the table. Both, I believe, in the backlog issue that we have, I think it's important that we look into innovative solutions that would bring the nonprofit sector into the table. We have great providers of housing that would bring them into the fold and the private sector to look into some of these solutions. But it's essential as well that as a housing strategy, we start looking into the private sector. And I think there's three big areas that we need to look into. It is home ownership, affordable home ownership. Making sure that we have rental opportunities, and I will go into more details into each of these areas if you ask me to, but I think it's essential that we look into affordable home ownership, the rental stock that we have, and opportunities as well to repair the existing rental stock that we have. And we can do that with policy as well, and in collaboration with the private sector.
Well, I'm not going to disagree with much of what's been said. I think that it's shocking to me that given the importance that housing has to every aspect of life in any city, but we'll deal with our own for the moment, that it doesn't get more priority from any level of government. It's an economic issue. I remember sitting at the transit forum, for example. I moderated one for the union when they had a transit forum about a year ago, and listening to the people talk about where they had to live and how they had to get to work. And the transportation issues, they're talking about how you catch buses, two buses at 5 o'clock in the morning, the street car, walk, various places that the subway was operated. But it also was a housing issue. They're talking about where they had to live, to afford to live, to have the jobs they had. These are jobs we needed them to have, for example, in hospitals. So there's just no question that we can't have affordable housing in the city, where there's going to be a lot of jobs that, by definition, are not going to be highly paid. Affordable housing is an economic problem. It's a health problem. And I think, again, we don't talk about it in that context, but the lack of adequate housing and the existence of a lot of inadequate housing, quite frankly, including a lot of housing that the council referred to in the Toronto Community Housing Projects, and I've been to many of them, and said many times, even when I was a politician and now that I'm a broadcaster, that they are in condition to consider to be disgraceful and unacceptable to most of us in terms of what we expect for a public asset, let alone places we expect our fellow citizens to live who are needed with So, is a national housing strategy a good solution to this? No. Is it likely to lead to some degree of greater stability of funding as opposed to the situation now where there seems to be it's not quite annual, but it's almost an annual sort of ritual we go through where people are uncertain as to whether the support that has been there is going to continue to be there, whether from the federal or the provincial governments or both. So, I think it would make some small contribution, but I think the key, and I hope some an area in which we can get some ideas tonight, is in what both the others referred to. I talk for 3 hours a day, there's no way I can get it. Is collaboration, what I call collaboration, which means the not just the token involvement, not just the sort of saying about now that the words were in the private sector, well, in fact, turning to them by private sector, I include that very much in the more so the nonprofit sector, where we've seen some established successes from the cooperative movement, from religious groups, from cultural groups, from sponsored engagement and programs, to do a very effective affordable housing program. I'll finish on this note, then you can deal with me later. The summit, the Civic Action Summit last year, we suggested that maybe the approach was to have a regional housing leadership group. They've got a New York region actually quite successful. They bring together around one table religious, government, private sector developers, etc. Put them all around the table and they deal there together with the challenge of trying to actually do something concrete with respect to the provision of affordable housing for people who need to cross out.
Thank you, John. That's great. Okay, so I'll jump into the next two or three questions and think about a question if you have one. Please log it down and then we'll open the floor to questions. So the first question I have, really a discussion on affordable housing has to start with Toronto Community Housing Corporation. And I think we'll shorten that to TCHC so everyone knows what we're talking about. And I actually want to read a quote written a few weeks ago by Toronto Star columnist John Fiorito about the TCHC. He writes, "There are people living in rooms with moldy walls and buildings where the elevators do not work, where the smell of urine lingers in the stairwells, and where people step over the litter of drug use. I know you can't fix these problems by selling housing stock. I know how complicated it is to deal with bed bugs. I know that TCHE has hired a bed bug specialist. I know the Titanic had lifeboats." I think this is a very significant point that Joe is making. The Titanic had lifeboats, but the entire design was flawed. Can we remodel TCHC? Can we redesign it? Or is the ship too big and poorly designed to work? Should we try a different approach, a new design for delivering affordable housing to those most in need? And Anna, I think we should probably start with you next. You have 2 minutes to answer, and Amanda is doing your comment.
I agree that we need to look at more than just selling houses. I heard a lot of reputations on this issue, but what really struck me was when tenants started asking, "Okay, so you're going to sell my house, we're going to sell the houses to fix my window, and what are you going to do next? Sell my house so you can fix somebody else's window?" What we need is a plan, and that's what we're working at City Hall. And that is not to say that some of it might not be sold. We have been selling. That's the other thing. I know that there was a big movement on with some associations in saying that not for sale. The reality is the status quo is not working. TCHC has not been doing a good job as a landlord. They just don't have the means to do it. So we need to change the status quo. We need to change it, and we have been doing. We've sold land at Regent Park, we've sold land at Alexander Park. That's really what we're doing. So we're going to have to look into those models as well, and we have to look at the governance model. Do we need one organization to look at the 60,000 units? The reality is that those 60,000 units and 160,000 tenants have a lot of different needs. We have supportive housing, we have senior housing, we have regular housing. A lot of people that all they need really is a rent supplement, to be honest with you. So you have a variety of issues that that TCHC is dealing that maybe need another governance model, and I think it's definitely something that that TCHC needs to look at.
Thank you. John?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I heard you alluding to sort of perhaps providing the Toronto Community Housing Corporation option. I'm just not sure if that's going to work either. I'm one of those who just believes that, you know, in a lot of cases, unfortunately, I have to say that I'm always proud to say I'm a progressive conservative, not a conservative. That's not right wing ideology that says government shouldn't be doing anything. I just don't think government runs the many of these things very well. And I think it's just endemic to the process. So I would not have the city proceed any further forward with, other than for disabled or mentally ill people, with owning or building any more housing. Because I just don't think they do it well. With respect to what you do with the existing corporation, I wouldn't sell it off, but I would find it under the government. I don't think dividing up is going to do that. I would also, I think we've got to think outside the box with respect to the existing assets we have. I mean, it's a disgrace we go out and run down where we have a whole level of $725 million repair backlog. I had an idea when I was in provincial politics are taking. I mean, if you look at every other piece of land in the city, every other piece of land, if you had this problem with it, it was property owned, it's inflated in value so much now that you could mortgage it and take the proceeds and renovate the building. And I don't know why we couldn't somehow capture some of the land underneath those houses, because in an interest-free mortgage, say, coming from the federal or the provincial government to hold, and it doesn't have to be for the full amount of money. And use that money then to repair these buildings properly, because again, it makes no sense for us to let them run down and run down and run down further and just keep talking about the backlog getting bigger. So I think we've got to think outside the box. I would make much greater use of two things, both of which Anna made reference to. One is, in no particular order, rent supplements, because we do have the luxury at the moment, I guess, of having a lot of space. And I don't want to say that it's affordable space, because not all of it is. Some of these condos are quite unaffordable. Helpful. If you have the space and you can sort of get people moving around in the system so that you can free up some of the space through a rent supplement that other people can use who need the help, then they'll have a supplement and it doesn't put people into sort of concentrated community. And the second is the sort of regional park, notwithstanding the criticisms in the Toronto Sun. I, on that day and many other papers before that, vigorously defended and promoted. Look, it won't prove to be a complete success when we analyze it 5 years from now and look back, but I think there's a lot of success in down there by, again, making use of the public resource of land, encouraging the private to come and invest, and having a community that is truly a mixed community. So, anyway.
Time's running out. I'll finish with 2 minutes.
Thank you. Certainly the model that the TCHC is now operating under has to obviously change, and the rationalization of its assets is absolutely necessary. And the idea of selling assets that are not meeting the objective certainly has to be reviewed. So I concur with Councillor Powell's approach that certain assets should be sold. And I think that John's absolutely right in suggesting that you use the asset that's there to try and find a different financing model. And there's a tremendous amount of value in that asset that can be tapped. So you have to start thinking outside the box. Is the TCHC too large? Probably, and also I would agree not to encourage them to do the typical mainstream type of housing delivery. They should look at the Regent Park model and try and duplicate that elsewhere. So it was very successful to create a mix of housing and to create a non-stratified cultural and social environment that all classes of people can live in. I think that's very, very important and should be an objective that's maintained. Certainly for the more needy type, the more needy who require certain special assistance, I think the TCHC has a definite role. The other thing we can't avoid also is this is a legacy issue. These assets do deteriorate over time. They're heavily used. That's not a big surprise. If you neglect them for decades, you get this massive bill. So when you start building new units, then the whole maintenance program has to also be part of the TCHC's responsibility. Because it's a legacy issue, I don't see how government can't step in this circumstance. Certainly, financing the asset is one creative way, but I think the upper levels of government or a special kind of tax to rectify the problems can be necessary. It's just too big a nut that rolled up over time. And certainly it's not going to be an easy solution.
Thank you. Do you want to rebut? Yeah. I'd just like to comment on something. John's recommendation, I really like it, but I had this conversation with TCHC and all of a sudden they tell me, yes, but we already have a debt of $2.2 billion. So, we have to also take that into consideration that there's a, on top of all this backlog, there's a debt already of TCHC of $2.2 billion. So just for you to have an idea of the problem. And the other thing that I think is really important that TCHC does is that when we're doing this, and I think that's why we put forward that working group, is that we need to have a real balance between a real estate strategy and a people's and housing strategy. And that's why it's so important when people say, okay, let's sell the 700 and something scattered houses and let's get rid of the scattered houses. Or we need to understand that there's a value, a social value in these things that we need to balance. This mixed-use communities, being in the condos, being in the buildings, it's really important to have a balance between the real estate strategy and the people and housing strategy.
Thank you. Actually, that's a great lead into my next question, which is legacy. It talks about legacy as well. We have what we call our pockets of poverty. What do we do about these pockets of poverty to try and kind of spread them out or something? Do you have any solutions to that, John?
Well, you don't want to spread them out, but I know what you mean. The first thing we have to do is revisit your model. It seemed like a great idea 6 years ago, which is to build sort of concentrated communities of people who are in need of assistance with their housing. That's one of the reasons why I'm so favorably disposed to rent something, because they don't represent government blue goggles getting involved in building and operating housing, which government just doesn't do well like many other things. And secondly, because it allows people to go and be mobile with their housing assistance and go wherever they can find a place. But I think we have what we have in terms of the communities that we established a number of years ago over time across the city. Of course, and many of them are now more suburban than they are urban in terms of downtown. And I think the first thing you have to do in the theory is that most of it is not going to be in need of being demolished, nor can we frankly afford to demolish it in the context of the law of supply and demand, is to repair it. And that's why I think there must be a way found. I think the debt you're referring to is the city's debt. In front of many houses, can't populate that debt as well.
There's somebody from TCHC.
But having just to sort of but just in defense of John's point though, if I were just to ascribe, and here I'm just going to add some real estate expertise to the equation, if you ascribe, let's just say $100,000 to the value to each one of your 58,000 units, it's $6 billion. Yeah. So there's a lot of equity there. So I would go back to the staff and say, excuse me, you know, step it up. Let's think a little more creatively in how we can tap into that.
Whatever that value is,
and 100
increase just because every other is in that as well.
And I'm using a very modest number. 100,000 per unit is much lower than replacement value. Much lower. So I think a lot of equity.
One of the reasons I was so bothered by the way in which the Sun dealt with the region record, which is it's not perfect, but is that it, I think it's quite discouraging. Going in where Daniel was prepared to be a pioneer. And they put up a lot of their own money, or at least they put it in.
The model that I would put out for the private sector's involvement, certainly the Daniels model and the city model and regional partner is hugely successful in urban neighborhoods, which we could apply that. Certainly, I think the next one on the radar screen is Lawrence and Mathers, MRS Heights, which is in dire need of a retrofit and a rethink. I think that would be a wonderful place to apply that model, and certainly it's unfortunate that the Sun took that cheap shot because it is discouraging. But our community, for example, and Anna and John talked about this quite well, but unless you force developers to do this and think about it, they're not going to do it. So the idea here would be to say to our community, you have to deliver. Let's just take 5%. And I use 5% because it's generally, I think, when you look at a financing model for a condo project, very doable. And you deliver 5% of the units in a building as affordable rental under the CMHC guidelines. And I think you need some tools, you need some help from the city, from government to do that. But it doesn't cost the taxpayer really anything. There's no upfront capital required. It does two things. One, it brings new stock into the system. It's socially integrated. It's interspersed in each building. You don't have to necessarily, it doesn't have to be congregated in one floor or one area. It's actually better. It's dispersed through the building. And if you force that 5%, let's take the last decade or so. We've had 200,000 new units, high-rise units, and I'm only talking high-rise units here, delivered across the CMA since 2001. If I took 5%, it's 10,000 units. It's about 14%. When you add 14% to the stock that CHC has, for example, it's a big number. 10,000 new units don't require repair for a long time, hopefully. And it's socially integrated. The tools the city have to bring to the table to incentivize the developers to do this are quite simple. For that portion only of those buildings where they retain and rent at the affordable level, wouldn't be taxed on realty taxes, and they wouldn't have to pay levies or impost fees for those units, only for those units. And that would incentivize them. It would make the model work, not only the capital cost to create them, but would also allow them to operate those units as rental units going forward with them in a break-even or slightly better than break-even potential.
Thank you. Anna?
I think the first step that we need to do is revise our official plan. We have some impediments right now with the definition of, for example, affordable home ownership that a lot of councillors trying to get as part of their Section 37 organizations, such as Habitat for Humanity and so on, Artscape and so on, and it's it, we find a lot of difficulty dealing with it because of the official plan. So I think that will help. Most of the development happening in the city is happening downtown, and we have the opportunity to work with the developers to get some of the Section 37 going into affordable housing that will be a section. So we are working towards that, and I think that will be helpful. I think that the land that the city owns, we need to do a better job of making sure that we have affordable housing, and right now we have, and Alfred has spoken about this, the 20% of land, but a lot of times we have the land and then we don't have the money to build on it. So I think we need to be smarter on it, because a lot of this land is happening, is being sold as in downtown Toronto, key areas that are getting extremely expensive to live in. That is important that in all this new development, that we are creating affordable housing in this community. So when we think about affordable housing, we think about all the areas of the city of Toronto, not certain areas. Another program that I think we need to strongly invest in is the tower renewal. And when I say invest, we can do it with policy as well, and making sure that we are working with the private sector to facilitate the infill of some of these towers that they have, to make sure that these towers are being renewed, that the rental stock, not only the TCHC stock that we have, but the rental stock, the many towers that we have in the city of Toronto are being renewed and renovated so that the rental that is available in there is in good condition as well.
Great, thank you. Okay, moving on to a different area of housing, I'll say. 9,000 of the 168,000 tenants who live in social housing have mental health issues, and they are not getting assisted living or special care they qualify for because we just don't have the funds. They are slipping through the cracks because responsibility is never assigned. What can be done to fix this situation? And I think, Alfredo, you're next.
I have to say I'm at a bit of a loss on that question because I don't have much experience with special assisted housing. Certainly affordable is something we've thought about and had to deliver in the past. But I have to be honest, and I think I'm probably reflective of a lot of people who just don't really understand that issue very well. I certainly don't, and I have to admit that. But certainly one idea, and of course my gauntlet up to the development industry, if you brought that question to the table, they'd run in the direction. Because it's fearful for them to try and engage in an investment environment where they think there's going to be other social problems associated with their development. It's hard enough to get them to get around the social housing, which is integrated into a lot of there's a lot of resistance to that, and I think that it's wrong in thinking. I think that assimilation is very important. How we deliver the special care units, I really don't know. I think that's where the TCHC really has to, that's where the government mandate really needs to be focused. They should get out of the business of providing housing for the general public on the affordability issue and on the affordability scale, and really focus, and I think John made this point, and really focus on special needs and deliver that housing.
Thank you.
Yeah, I remember, you know, to me, I mean, it's a housing problem, but it's less a housing problem, more of a staffing problem, because the physical accommodation is often available. I mean, we went through this exercise, we're doing it again now with respect to people who are developed and disabled, but where we concluded directly that it was wrong to institutionalize people in big, you know, institutions that sort of had resemblance to prisons, and we sort of closed those all down very efficiently and didn't place that are put in place in the community any kind of community-based setting for people to live, those with mental health issues and others. And the problem is that there isn't a staff that's funded. I think you mentioned in your question, Sarah, the funding problem. It is, if you fund it adequate numbers of people to provide the assistance these people need, it's less of a fiscal problem. There's a fiscal problem too in terms of housing availability. And I think that what you just said, Alfredo, a moment ago, is correct, which is that the fact of what I was saying. I think we should try to be involved less and maybe find ways in some respects to withdraw from providing general housing and replace that more with rent supplements and developments that are undertaken by the nonprofit and or the private sector, and have the public sector focus on the people most in need that are most vulnerable, where people who are disabled, people who are mentally challenged, and people who are developmental handicapped and so on. And put some of the money, I mean, there's been so many reports written on this. It's like I'm now supposed to be doing the 12th report on terrorism, but there's 11 others that they're writing down. I hope they pay attention to this one. But, you know, at the end of the day, there's been so many reports written on assisted housing. The last one I remember being written by Mike Wilson, the former federal finance minister, who was a keen interest in mental health. And he said, you simply have to set some simple targets for yourself. They aren't that big in terms of numbers, of the number of assisted housing units you're going to put in place on an annual basis to get to the number you need. And it really hasn't been done. It's done on a sort of scattering basis. Once in a while, there's a lecture coming out or something, and then that's it. Nobody ever pays any attention. As a result, I'll talk about these things very much.
I say that's when, this is where the city, once again, is doing the province's job. We have that case at TCHC, but I would like to actually bring a specific case, pilot project that I'm doing in my ward, where we've been successful in working with a nonprofit organization. So I had a tower in my ward that was probably known citywide on Lansdowne and Dupont, very bad tower. And we worked with the landlord, we worked with CAMH and UHN, and we worked with Madison, which is a housing provider. We now have over 30 units of people that used to be at CAMH at $150,000 a bed, that really didn't need to be in the CAMH, but actually could be more integrated into the community. We've renovated, the building is actually being totally renovated. The landlord is happy because he's getting almost 40 units that is actually getting stable rent. And he gave a couple of units so that support staff can help these people 24/7. They're there to remind them about their medication. They're there to work with these people. And instead of being at CAMH at $150,000 a bed, they are in a bachelor or a one bedroom. Some of them, it's actually family in a two bedroom, being assisted by a nonprofit organization. And I think these are the pilot projects that we need to motivate. We're rebuilding a building, we're renovating a building, we're making it better, we're taking people out of these institutions, and we're supporting them on a 24/7 basis at a much cheaper cost. And I think this is the way that we need to move forward, where the government is there to facilitate, the government is there to help, but the people that really understand these issues, these nonprofit organizations, people like CAMH and UHN, they have the opportunity to work with these people.
Agreed. Thank you. Okay, housing area. I'm just wondering, who exactly are these people? Are they short term, long term? What percentage are people who are handicapped and will always need assistance? What percentage are just people who are trying to get a job? I mean, I think if you can't combine your tenants' building, then you'll have a hard time finding the right accommodation for them.
When I got to City Hall, I got a new councillor. I've just been elected for a year and a half. I started as chair of the Affordable Housing Committee. One of the questions I asked is, who are these 80,000 people? Are they mostly seniors? We are looking into that. We are having a study, but right now we don't know. That's another problem that we have. And my question is, how do you expect me to have a strategy for something that I don't know exactly who they are? So we've had a preliminary report on that. I don't have the numbers with me, but it's something that the city is looking into. And we need to have a real look
into who are we building housing for, who are we housing in at TCHC. But truth be told, I mean, we're always hitting on TCHC, that they don't do a good job, and they're young. I mean, we also have to understand that their funds have been decreasing. Their fundings are still decreasing on a yearly basis by the federal government. And it's continuing to happen. So the pressure on TCHC is increasing and the funds are decreasing. So there's a lot of things that we need to look into TCHC. I think there's a governance issue that needs to be looked into at TCHC. But we also have to understand the pressure that the TCHC is under.
Thank you.
Don, did you have a comment?
No.
Hi, I am from TCHC, so I'll just give a couple facts, just in answer to your question, who lives at TCHC. Over 50% of the units are bachelors or one bedroom, so it gives you a sense of the size of households we can have. 25% of the households are seniors, and about 31-32% are receiving OW or OPSB, so they have a fixed income of sorts. The rest are earning incomes of various sorts. However, it's much more complicated than that because households have more than one source of income, so they may have OW or OPSB, but also be working. So there's a range of things that are going on, and it's more complicated. One of the reasons that Anna mentioned that costs are going up and our revenue stays flat, our rental revenue stays flat because people pay 30% of their income, it's pretty well fixed. An average rent might be $375. But costs, as you can imagine, keep going up. So just a couple of things.
Thank you for that. We have a question.
Just as a backed up of curiosity, the average income of somebody that lives at TCHC is $14,000?
The average
household?
$16,000.
And New York is about $25,000? Just as a comparison. Thank you. The question?
I'm David Walsh. I'm a businessman. I volunteer on a nonprofit that's leasing some houses from TCHC for challenges. And you know, from an economic standpoint, I see that it really makes sense because the like in one house we have five people looking very low incomes. And you know, they're getting support from a community organization, St. John the Compassionate here around the corner, that's providing support, and another one we're partnering with Margaret Fraser House. And so there's partners in the community and there's volunteers. And if we had to relocate those five people into five apartments, you know, we could figure out the cost of that. So it really makes sense to use these scattered units. They're small scale, they're integrated into neighborhoods. So I just wonder why we can't use more of the scattered units for this use.
I can start with that. This is exactly what the special working group is looking at. Can we work with other nonprofit organizations? I mean, there's no question that it is more expensive to operate the TCHC scattered houses than to operate the units. But if we can maintain the stock in the affordable housing portfolio, it doesn't necessarily have to be operated by TCHC, but if we can maintain it into the affordable housing portfolio, maybe with some of those organizations, for example, Habitat for Humanity already said they wanted to buy quite a number of them. If we can have that, that's the solution that we need to move forward. Instead of just selling, okay, let's sell it in the open market, which would reduce the stock. So if we can work with organizations such as yours, I believe that's the way to go, and that's exactly what the special working group is looking at.
I think you have to look at it on a case-by-case basis, but I'm not convinced. I mean, I was a business person before I was in politics and before broadcasting, and I just think that, you know, while it's fine to say that, you know, that we have those houses and we should use them, I think if you really took an honest look at the cost of servicing and operating all of those scattered houses all over the place, and then you look at the flip side of it, which is the value that could be derived from those houses, because they are undoubtedly dramatically increased in value as every other house in Toronto. that you find it didn't make any sense to keep them, and that you would end up, if you sold, maybe not all of them, but many of them, with funds, you could then put to better use, either renovating, creating properties, or even doing something more sensible for the kind of people that your organization serves. So it's one of the reasons.
But you know, if you're building a new housing, you probably only put, have 30% of vulnerable people. You probably only have 30% of vulnerable people in the development, and the rest would be more in market. So you're spending all that public money, and you're only getting a third of the units. And these houses, you know, like they're 100% serving the vulnerable population. And this house I'm talking about at Queen and Broadview is maybe worth $500,000 or $600,000. If you move those five people to existing TCHC units, you might be right. But if you have to build new units, you know, it would certainly be a lot more expensive. So you really got to look at the economics. I'm a real estate developer, so you know, I know the economics, and I'd be glad to show them to you.
Question. Oh, Bob has a question.
If I could just add as well, is that the 2,000 people that currently live in the TCH, those Havard houses, they had to be relocated into the TCHC, basically market units. So we're going to be losing market units, we're going to be creating condominiums that are going to have more of the low income, and we're going to be losing the revenue of the market rents that we have. So we need to be careful. Again, I'm not saying that we need to save all the houses. There are probably a group of them that need to be sold. But we need to look at some of those families that can buy the houses. We have had deputants at City Hall that came and said I want to buy the house. And we have organizations such as Habitat for Humanity that said, we want to help those families buy the house. So let's put that together. Let's work with some organizations. And at the end of the day, I do believe that some of the houses in the portfolio will need to have to be put up for sale. But we need to look at these houses and the people that live in the house and the organizations that are working at the houses.
Hi, I'm Bob Burnett, I'm an architect, and I've had the good fortune of designing 1,000 beds of student residence housing that's worked very successfully as a form of shared housing. So I'd like to ask about the housing model that we're using. Like in the old days, there were rooming houses, there were residential hotels, and I know that the shared housing that I built has been very successful with students. And at the time, just a few years ago, I'd given up trying to build affordable housing because I wasn't having any progress. We could build these units, shared units, for about $25,000 per person versus other subsidized housing that I was building, where you're building an apartment unit at $125,000 per person. So I'll just say that I also have some friends that live out in the country, and there are 20 families that all live together, and they share communal space, share the dining. That's working very successfully. Now, granted, those people don't have mental health difficulties, but that I'm wondering whether we're too locked into the housing model of everybody having to have everything in the one unit.
Thank you, Bob. Alfredo, do you want to answer?
I think it's an intriguing question to look at the kind of product that's being delivered. I think it's worth a hard look, and I think it's already happening, actually, because you've got various organizations that have specific design requirements, typically in the singles and in the live-work environment, units will take on a different form, and they'll be usually smaller and less expensive to build, so that's already happening. I have to say, though, that I don't think, generally speaking, in an urban environment, the communal ideas are where people move on in their lives and become students. So I think that they cease to be students at some point, at least most of us. I have a couple of children who are still students, or should be. But you basically got to look at the social circumstances surrounding that kind of environment and whether we're serving the needs of those people or not. I know it's a tough question, but as I said, I think in an urban environment, communal living, I'm sure it's the answer. Certainly revisiting the type of unit that we're building is absolutely necessary because, and I think they're going through that right now. Certainly the Pan Am Village is an example of how that have a certain function at the outset for this kind of communal living, and then can be turned into market and or assisted housing once they've gone through that exercise. So it's definitely possible, and there's certainly not been enough thought given to design modifications that, and the type of dwelling units we're
making. In a way, if you can say that we've got to think outside the box on this, and that's why I'm such a believer that if you bring in, I mean, if you go back to one of the programs that worked well, I think people say it was quite expensive relative to the degree of government subsidy that came both in those days, mainly from CMHC, but also from other levels of government. The projects that involved the religious communities, the cooperative housing movement, and some of the cultural organizations, they stand today, they're quite old now, because they were built 34 years ago, the sort of Czechoslovakian community or whatever. These, they weren't that innovative in their built form, but they were people took on as an organization, and they cared for and continued to operate this housing for a lot of their seniors. And I think if we turn back to some of those organizations, including people like you, and said, all right, now bring us a model that will work financially, but that also may have a different feature about it, whether it's shared accommodations that are, whatever you call it, shared space, shared common space or whatever, who knows? But if we don't ask people, they're never given consent. We turn us to the same old sort of government blueprints over and over again, and you get the same result. It's the old same definition of insanity. Engaging in the same behavior and expect a different result. So I think we're going to talk about a principle in terms of involving an imaginative approach that comes from people who are not the same old people would produce dividends for us and some new ideas that would work financially and otherwise.
Anna, did you want to add something?
I just want to add that when we talk about housing, we can't just talk about one solution fits all, because people have different needs. Like I said, we have people that what they need is supportive housing. We have people that all they need is a rent supplement. We talk about this list, and that's why I think it's really important that we look into this list, because we don't have 80,000 people living in the streets of Toronto. They're housed. So a lot of them with a rent supplement probably solve their issue. But there are other ones that doesn't matter what rent supplement you give them, what they need is supportive housing or seniors housing. Or, there's families that we could actually maybe break that cycle and move them into home, affordable home ownership. So there's different solutions in the housing, in the affordable housing portfolio. We need to move into, we need to have these options available. Because one thing that I think is important is that we need to move people in this cycle. We need to break this cycle. I think it's important to have this idea that we need to help people to move, to go from a rent supplement or a TCHC, and to see if they can move into the next stage and have those things available. I think that's also important about while we're developing the housing strategy, that we have those options available.
Thank you. Let's just start first with Anna's ideas.
I mean, Nick has been knocking at all the right doors. The issue is we got the federal provincial agreement signed, and the city did get funding, but we got $108 million that has to last us until 2015. That's a drop in the bucket. And so the city divided this into rent supplements, into some money for home ownership, into new build, and into renovations to help with the tower renewal project. So it's very, very little money that we have to help projects such as this one. And that's why it's essential that that we do it. It has to be in partnership with organizations such as Build. It has to be with some tax alleviation, and not so much giving you the cash up front, but maybe cash incentive, tax incentives. That's the only way we're going to be able to do it in the city.
Okay. I feel your pain. I know it's very, very difficult to construct a strictly social housing project from scratch without assistance. It's almost impossible. I think you have to lower your sights, though, and perhaps maybe accept that you could build rather than having a whole loaf, you have part of a loaf, and then you marry some market housing to your assisted housing objectives. That's probably the best way to proceed. I also seek out from the councilor and your colleagues, complete relief, tax relief on all the units, complete levy relief, and hopefully Bill is giving you the land if you're actually going to carry this out, because that would certainly reduce your cost. But it certainly points up the model that I was proffering, which is simple, because it basically is self-financed. Again, the numbers are much smaller. You don't get these one-shot buildings. But by reducing the percentage and spreading it over all the units that are being built is a fair and equitable way of getting the development community off their butts and involved in this environment, because they're not right now, except for the few like yourself and Daniels and some of the others. And that's what really needs to happen. It's not the only solution, but it can be a big part of the solution. And certainly, I commend your efforts. And I would get Scotiabank to allow you to provide second mortgage financing for your assisted purchasing, for your market housing, for your purchasers who can't afford a down payment. It's one thing that I've been talking about for a long time and would certainly offer up. We need the banks to help you, because banks will not accept financing, first mortgage financing, if the developer is providing a second to the purchaser, they'll just reject it out of hand. And so the banks have to step up as well and say, yes, we'll allow you to put a second mortgage on this property.
Yeah. Sorry.
Hi, I'm Yvette Roberts. I'm the coordinator of Young Parents No Fixed Address. We've been around 15 years with about 30 agencies collaborating across the country addressing housing issues faced by young parents. I think for me, whenever we have this talk about affordable housing, there's two key issues. One starts off with the definition. Affordable housing is 20% below the market rent, which means that my current apartment, my two-bedroom apartment that I live in Scarborough, would be deemed affordable housing. What I pay is 40% of my income as a full-time professional person. What I pay is the exact amount that a mother with one child on welfare gets in total. Yet my place would be considered affordable based on the definition of affordable housing would be cost of the rents across, you have to deal with the rents across Toronto. So the definition alone of affordable housing, I don't qualify for Habitat for Humanity and options for homes. Well, Habitat for Humanity said that I need to have five children based on their criteria. I need to have about four or five children based on my income to qualify. And yet, you know, I also don't qualify to buy a house just on the general market here in Toronto or even Scarborough, you know, for that matter. So again, it's that whole definition of affordable housing. I think the other key piece, we lost between 2000 and 2008, we lost 66,000 rental units that cost $600 to $900. Yet we gained 48,000 rental units that cost $1,100 and above, which are those same units. They didn't do anything. They just put the rent up because that's what they can do.
Okay, can we go focus on
so my question is, one, can we please redefine the definition of affordable housing to make it more realistic for those of us who are truly working with low-income people who are in shelters? And secondly, I truly, you know, support the idea of rental supplements. And for those on welfare, it's a simple matter of increasing the shelter amount. A mother with one child is allowed $550 a month for rent. Doesn't exist, you know, and I have a problem.
It goes back to addressing the problems. There's just no money. What do we do? You know, what are the next steps?
I think everyone who spoke is in agreement. There's quite a list of partners, the government, not-for-profit, developers, etc., who need to be brought to a table and be giving their minds and their passion and energy for this problem together to come up with some real solutions to a very complex issue. I look at this room tonight and I see how many empty chairs there are. I know how many people work really hard to get the message out about the subject of this meeting tonight. So my question to all of you on the panel is just this. What are your top two ideas about how to get all of those parties motivated enough to come to this mythical table and surrender and take this on as an issue that needs their time and energy now?
Okay,
down to Mr. Brown?
Well, I suggest the one model we've already, again, I'm a great believer that you don't try and reinvent the wheel to find things that work, then you can replicate them. I cited the example by the New York region, they do these regional housing leadership groups, and they're not meant to just sit around and have a gab fest, they're meant to sit together and bring people around the table. I mean, it's really what Civic Action does that I'm privileged to be the chair of. You get people to sit around the table who ordinarily don't sit with each other. Labor, business, nonprofit organizations, they sometimes run into each other in their travels. And I think something like that is maybe the process part of it and the ingenuity part of it. And then you come up against the one that I'm not sure I have the answer to, which is the money side. Because you can have all the ingenious people you want thinking of all the ideas back to our point earlier about whether it's a shared base or this or that. And there isn't the money to help to seed these projects. You know, historically, if you look at all the ones that have been done well, whether it's the most recent one in Regent Park, whether it's one way back, and some of these other ones that I referred to, they're cooperative or religious based or community or culturally based, they had generous support from the governments to make them happen. And I'm not sure that we're going to find any combination of people who sit at even as good an idea as this regional housing leadership table that are going to sit there and dream up a way to do this for money that doesn't, you know, money that can't be recovered from the tenants. Otherwise, it would be done by somebody with such a good idea that somebody in the private sector would be doing it already on their own without any help from anybody. So I think that's a fundamental problem. I think that's going to require recognition on the part of the two senior levels of government in particular that they have to provide, you know, when you hear Anna talk about the numbers of the money they have received for the next 2 or 3 years under the current agreements. A total of 100 million divided by the 7 areas they have to cover divided by 3 or 4 years. It's not very much, I mean, to say the least. So I don't have an answer, I wish I could on that one. I suggested my answer not knowing the Hassan Corporation, I'm horrified here, has a debt of its own of $2 billion, notwithstanding Alfredo's comments about the value. It's still horrifying here that there's more debt sitting around out there than all of them. And somebody like me that tries to keep very well informed of these things.
I think at the city we've been trying to reach out to some of these members. As part of our affordable housing committee, we do have a round table that we bring some of these members on a regular basis from United Way, Board of Trade, Building the Trades, some of the nonprofit organizations, the Toronto Apartment Association. So they're all part of a round table that I meet with them on a regular basis, and we're actually going to come out with a report on our May 28th meeting on some of the discussions that we've had and some of the recommendations to our executive to try to tackle some of these issues. But it needs to be done, I believe, at least on a regional basis. And I think we need the help of the media, we need the help of our leaders. And one thing we have to say is that our mayor does bring a lot of attention to this issue. The fact that he goes around and visits these buildings, TCHC buildings, he does bring attention to the housing issue. So I hope that he continues to do that because it's definitely helping my task of bringing the attention to the issue and stakeholders to the tables as well. So I think politicians, leaders in the community, the media, all have a job to make sure that this is part of the agenda. I always say there's two crucial issues that the city's facing right now is transit and housing. I think those are the two most important issues that we need to tackle in the city of Toronto. So hopefully some more city politicians think like that, we can move forward. Thank you.
Yeah. I think certainly the idea of bringing all of the stakeholders to the table on a regular basis is absolutely critical because the exchange of ideas and as John's point was made earlier, well taken, not just to have a chit chat but to actually roll up your sleeves and come up with real solutions. As for my industry, I can assure you that when the provincial government and federal government announced their joint funding a few years ago, it was a significant sum of money. All of a sudden, there was a whole bunch of my people from my industry that were all of a sudden interested in social housing. It's human nature, it's no surprise. But once that funding dried up, can't find them. No one's interested. So it's important to, I think, for our industry, you have to, as I said earlier, you have to force them to the table, you have to mandate this. But you have to mandate it with an even-handed, fair approach. What we have now is so inconsistent in one area of the city, it's one thing, in another it's something else, or it doesn't exist at all, and then you got to count the councilor, allow us to sit me down and say, well, you have to deliver this, because we need it. And then the discussion begins, and then we come up with a greater solution. I mean, I would do it anyways, and I've done it on my initiative, but it's important that we make this a mandatory obligation for my community. And I think that's where it has to start with the development industry. That's all I can say about it, really. You need to incentivize them. And you incentivize them not only with a fiscal model that works, but you also have to call on their social obligation. I mean, if you're truly a city builder, then this is what you're going to engage in. You're not just going to build bricks and mortar, you're going to try and create a social fabric. You have to put your money where your mouth is.
Excellent, thank you. There's so many questions, and I hate to say this, but we're at the end of the hour here. So I want to thank you for being here. I also want to thank my volunteers tonight. I don't know if you can stick around and do it. Calls for this great space. This is beautiful, isn't it? I just love it. As well as our sponsors, Castle Point, Beck Taxi, Tribute, Sabera Group, they made this happen. So I thank you all. I also want to thank the panelists tonight for their time.